All right, awesome. Well, thanks, guys. We're going to go ahead and get rolling now. I know we still have some people coming in the room, but I want to get started here right at 2. So we're going to have plenty of time for Q&A at the end. So I've got a lot of stuff that I want to cover here, and I'm going to go through it as quickly as we can. So if you have any questions, just kind of hold them for me at the end, because we'll have a lot of time for Q&A. With that said, let's go ahead and jump right in. So as the slide says, we're going to be talking about everything that you need to know about high frequency trading. And I'm going to give you a little background on myself and like I said, hopefully handle some of the misconceptions that are being portrayed in the media about high frequency trading. Before we dive in, I'll just say, you know, trading's risky. There's no guarantees or certainties in trading, and a lot of people lose money. I'm not a trading advisor or anything like that. So feel free to read the full disclaimer on our site. So let's talk about what we're going to talk about. The first thing we're going to look at is what HFT really is and how it affects you as a trader or an investor. And it really doesn't matter what market or time frame you're trading. HFT, or high frequency trading, affects everybody. You know, I think the only people that it might not really affect are long-term investors who might buy Microsoft today and then hold on to it for years and years. But if you are a day trader, a swing trader, you know, if you're trading anywhere from a few seconds to a few weeks or more, this absolutely has an effect on you. We're also going to talk about, you know, a lot of the misconceptions that are being portrayed about HFT, and really how to win in the current trading arena, because as it says down here, you know, a lot of strategies are completely 100% obsolete right now. And I want to show you the strategies that I think are going to stand the test of time, at least, you know, in the near future, the next few years. Who knows what's going to happen with artificial intelligence and that kind of stuff. But I think at least over the next 3 to 5 years, I want to show you what I think is going to continue to work. So just a little bit of a background on me. I actually started trading back around 2001. And if you don't know me, by the way, my name is Chris Dunn. If this is your first webinar, I'm the founder of the E-Mini Trading Academy. And at the Academy, we focus on the futures market. But I also trade equities or stocks, as well as I'm diving into the Bitcoin market slowly but surely. And I've actually been extremely accurate in that market on my predictions and my trades so far, which is pretty interesting. But going back to 2001, when I was in high school, it was a really interesting time. You know, if we look at, if I can get this chart to catch up with my voice here, if we go back and look at where the market was, and this is a monthly chart of the E-mini S&P 500. Okay, so this is going back to 2001 when I first started trading, all the way up to here in mid-2014. One thing you'll notice is in 2001, 2002, we were coming off of the tech bubble, right? And the market was crashing, but you'll notice the volume that was traded back then was significantly lower, right? Because the futures market was just starting to get popular back here. And just to give you like a story, so I was in high school, but I was working at a mortgage company. And when I was at this mortgage company, one of the guys there was showing me his monitor, which back in the day we had those huge obnoxious monitors, and he was day trading stocks and also E-mini futures. And he would just take hundreds and sometimes thousands of trades a day. He was in and out, in and out, in and out, buy and sell, buy and sell. And he was just scalping all over the place. And the guy on average made a few hundred bucks or a few thousand dollars a day. And I thought that was really interesting. So I started doing the same thing. Now, fast forward a few years, I noticed a shift in market conditions in 2008. Okay, so, you know, from 2001, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, the market through here was gaining volume. We were in kind of that slow bull trend. And then 2008 hit, and this changed everything, okay? This is when the financial crisis hit, But I think the financial crisis kind of masked what was happening with high-frequency trading. You know, even in the face of a massive panic here, you know, day traders back then were doing really well because there was a lot of emotion in the market. But this is when, you know, high frequency really started to evolve into a pretty significant part of the market. And I wasn't really keen on what exactly was happening. I just noticed that there was something significantly different than back here from 2001 to like 2006 or 7. And fast forward to the flash crash of 2010, this was like the first time that the public really understood the power of high frequency trading. It really freaked a lot of people out. And you know, if you aren't aware of what the flash crash was back in 2010, I was actually in Argentina. We were in, I think it was called San Telmo, in this little town square, having coffee after some trading. And my wife now, Nikki, came screaming like, "Look, guys, the market's crashing. Something's going on." We ran inside, and you know, it was incredible. The market just dumped off and recovered. And then all of a sudden, everybody started talking about HFT for the first time. Nobody really understood it, but they knew that something, you know, interesting had caused that. Fast forward to where we are today, you know, if you look kind of in hindsight, you can see we've been, since 2009, we've just been in a massive bull run. And from 2012 and 13 and 14, volume has been kind of dropping off, right? We've been fading volume during the bull market. And I think it's interesting just to note that, you know, HFTs are still over, and nobody really knows the exact number, but I think it's well over 50 to 60% of trading volume. And that's really important and interesting to know, and we'll talk about why in a second. But basically, since the shift in market conditions, I've been studying HFT and have been constantly working to adapt to changing market conditions. I've developed strategies in the e-mini futures market and the stock market and now the Bitcoin market. So let's just talk about, you know, what is high frequency trading? There's a misconception on exactly what it is, and let me just give you kind of the basic definition. So algorithmic trading is basically any kind of trading executed by computers. So you can have an algorithm execute a swing trade, you know, where you buy today and you sell on Friday, or a position trade where, you know, you're holding for months, or a day trade or scalp trade. It doesn't matter. Algorithmic trading just simply means computerized trading. High frequency trading is like a subset of algo trading. It's very, very fast, like super, super fast. We're talking the speed of light fast algorithmic trading. And Wikipedia defines it as the use of sophisticated technological tools, if I can talk, and computer algorithms to rapidly trade securities. HFT uses proprietary trading strategies carried out by computers to move in and out of positions in seconds or fractions of a second. And they are now fighting amongst each other for, you know, microseconds. And so right now, there's kind of this public perception of HFT, where, you know, this book, Flash Boys, recently came out by Michael Lewis, and this is really, I think, what's brought all this HFT stuff to the surface to the general public. And what they talk about is controversial strategies like front running and quote stuffing, which, you know, we'll talk about in a little bit. A few years ago, they came out with this documentary called Floored, where it basically talks about the downfall of the pit trader. You know, it used to be 5, 10, 15 years ago, the best traders were human traders physically in the pits in New York and Chicago, where they were literally screaming at each other and fighting. And now that's pretty much died off. And I actually have a video on YouTube from, I think it was 2009, where I went to the Chicago Mercantile Exchange and I looked at the S&P pit. And granted, it was on a Friday, but the pits were completely dead. I was just taken back. I didn't understand. And I think even, you know, further on down the road in 2014 now, it's even less active. So you'll hear people like on the video that we played before we got started, they'll say things like the market is rigged. And excuse me, HFTs, or, you know, their game is all about skimming pennies or fractions of pennies. That's partially true, but that's not entirely true. And so I'm going to save you a lot of like the technical jargon, and because this stuff is very, very, very complicated. I've been studying it for a long time, and I even go cross-eyed whenever I start really diving into it. So I'm going to try to keep things as simple as possible and really just give you what you need to compete and what like some actionable things that you can use for your own trading. So the high frequency trading edge is really all about speed. You know, they live in microseconds. And like I said a few times, I mean, they're now getting close to the speed of light. It's freaking scary, man. And just to give you like an idea of how much money is going into this, they recently built a $300 million fiber optic cable between the exchange or that area on Wall Street to the Chicago Mercantile Exchange so they could execute orders quicker. And there are things called co-location where there are companies that are just setting up these massive warehouses of basically high-speed computers where you can get an edge the closer you are to the exchange, right? Because somebody who's executing an order, say, where I'm at today in Ireland, if somebody is sitting, like physically, they're trading in New York, if we're competing on a high-frequency basis, guess who's going to win? Somebody in New York or somebody in Chicago, because it takes, and I don't know the exact number, but it takes a little bit longer, like a fraction of a second, for my order to get to the exchange than somebody who's actually there. And so the second benefit and another thing to add to their edge is that they actually get special treatment from the exchanges, and they have special orders where they can basically cut in line. And remember earlier when I said that, you know, over half of the trading volume today is done by high frequency firms. The reason why they get special treatment is because the exchanges make a ton of money off of these high frequency robots. And basically, you know, they're incentivized to give these guys more business. And, you know, we'll talk about if that's right or wrong. I don't really care. I just want to know how to make money going forward. And one thing I just want to say is that we cannot beat them at their own game. If you try to compete with HFT, I can guarantee you one thing, you will lose. So I think trading and winning at the game of trading going forward is all about finding a way around that and not directly competing with them and knowing how to work around it. Yeah, Val said, I actually heard that they're streaming data between towers that project light through lenses, and it's faster than fiber optic. Yeah, yeah, and you guys probably saw that video of the Wall Street Code. That was a great one with Chaim. So, yeah, I mean, that's basically the game there. Now, let's talk about some myths with HFTs. So one thing that I mentioned earlier, and a lot of the stuff that you guys will hear, like on 60 Minutes or, you know, a lot of the news reports that come out about this stuff, they talk about the game of hyper scalping for rebates and pennies. Basically, that these HFTs are basically fighting each other and fighting you to make a penny here and a penny there. And while that's true, while that's part of the game, that's not the entire game. Okay. And for those of you that don't know, you can actually get paid rebates if you play your orders right in the stock market. Like, you can actually get paid for providing liquidity. And while that's one way that these guys make money, that's not the entire puzzle. In fact, it's a pretty small piece of the pie. But just to give you kind of an idea of what they're talking about, so whenever you hear, like on 60 Minutes or whenever you read Flash Boys or anything like that, what they're basically talking about with this hyper scalping game is where they're placing thousands and thousands of orders in seconds, where they're basically fishing for slower orders. So remember, they get preferential treatment where they can actually cut in line so they can get to orders quicker than you can. And so, you know, they're going to be able to make a few cents here and a few cents there a lot quicker than you would. And that's why I said, you know, scalping is basically dead. And what they're doing is they're manipulating the bid-ask prices to make a few pennies or get paid a rebate for providing that liquidity. And these are typically on like lower volatility, but highly, highly liquid stocks. For example, you know, Bank of America, BAC, this is a stock that trades massive daily volume. So, you know, they're trading anywhere from 50 to 100 million shares a day on average. But if you look at the volatility, it's pretty low. Like it doesn't really move a whole lot compared to, you know, futures or, you know, low cap, you know, OTC stocks, micro cap stocks, stuff like that. Like the volatility is a lot less. They don't need volatility because they're getting paid on a per share basis. So what this creates for them is a good scalping environment. And so my advice to you is if you're trading stocks, stay away from this crap, like altogether. Stay away from the, you know, the super large cap, low volatility stuff. You know, if we look at the top 12 stocks here, like your GE's and Microsoft's and AT&T's, and, you know, I'm even going to go as far as saying, you know, you probably want to stay away from the Facebooks and the Twitters, and look for lower priced, not so heavily liquidated stocks, meaning like anything that trades over 10 million shares a day, I look for that algo activity. And we'll dive more into this in a little bit, but that's just kind of a preface. So that was kind of one strategy, was the whole rebate, you know, flash order type stuff. But there's actually more profitable HFT strategies that are more detrimental to you and more dangerous for you as a day trader or a swing trader or a longer term trader. You know, if you're not scalping, then that stuff may or may not affect you. I mean, it will affect you getting filled, and it will affect, you know, it's kind of like paying the high frequency tax. That's kind of how I put it. You know, they're going to beat you to orders, and there's no way around that. But let's talk about some other things that they do that are actually very powerful and very dangerous. The biggest one is hunting for your stops. You know, this is their game. This is what they do, and this is their main motive, is they are chasing down your stops. And I've talked about this since 2008. You know, I started pointing out patterns saying, look, guys, you know, what they used to teach in the technical analysis books, this stuff is just getting run over. And then over the years, it became easier and easier to kind of back test and forward test the stuff that you learn in technical analysis books. And that stuff is just obsolete. And we'll talk about that here in a second as well. But the second thing they do is probing and playing momentum. Basically, they're trying to create panics or over-exuberant bullish runs. In other words, they're just trying to create big moves that they can piggyback on. And then the third thing is beating and faking out the market during news. Okay, so number one, hunting for your stops. Basically, when you're trading and you place a stop order in, if you're following like a technical analysis 101 book, if you've ever sat there and gone, man, it seems like the market grabs my stop and then goes, you're not just being paranoid. That's really happening. You know, if you're following the common knowledge and the stuff that's been out there for a while, the algos are designed to fight you, to take your orders and to stop you out and take your money. That's what they do. Some of the probing and playing momentum strategies are actually, believe it or not, helpful for momentum traders like me and everybody at the E-Mini Academy. They can actually provide liquidity and cause big moves in the market that can actually help us. So when everybody's like talking about, you know, oh, high frequency trading is so bad, it, you know, I'm not going to talk about my own personal feelings if it's right or wrong. It is what it is, you know, and this is, it's not like an evil corporation. It's the way technology is developing. And so you have to be privy to it and accept it or get out of the game, basically. And then, you know, beating and faking out the market during news. Let me show you an example of this. So yesterday, okay, so I'm going to show you a couple examples. And let me wait for this chart to come up. So this is the ES, which is the E-mini S&P, which is the main market that we focus on at the E-mini Trading Academy. This is a 2 minute chart from yesterday. So the market opened here at 8:30 Central Time. Remember, this is on Central, so it's 9:30 Eastern. And then the Fed minutes announcement came out. What some people will do is they'll try to trade as a news piece comes out, as GDP comes out, as CPI, housing news, as any major news piece comes out. You'll have people that will look to piggyback on a big run. But one thing that algos are very, very good at is trading during earnings, like earnings season. If you ever try to trade equities after their earnings come out, algos are all over that stuff. Also, like yesterday when the Fed announcement or the minute notes were released here at 2 Eastern or 1 Central, you'll notice what happened here. The market was testing intraday highs. Okay, so this was clear resistance, and you had a lot of like rookie traders that were sitting back looking for a breakout, a technical breakout, because that's what they teach you in the technical analysis books. And where do they tell you to put your stop on the technical analysis books? Well, below the last pivot low, right? So what happens is the announcement comes. Price starts to shoot up. And granted, this is like 5 minutes after the announcement. So this isn't in a flash of a second. This gives the market time to suck everybody who's buying the breakout in, and they know that they're going to put their stops right behind this pivot low. Look where the market comes. Bam, comes all the way down, grabs those stops, and even sucks in some short sellers who shorted the break of that support level and then comes back up and makes a higher high. So it takes the money of everybody buying the breakout, takes the money of everybody shorting the breakdown, and then runs away laughing. That's exactly what happened yesterday. So that's one example. Let me give you kind of the four ways before we look at the other examples. Let me give you the four ways how HFTs hunt for stops. Number one is fake out breakouts, like the example that I just gave you, where it breaks the technical level, fakes everybody out, and slams back. Number two is they low tick or high tick pullback areas, meaning let's say you're going to buy on a retracement, right? Let's say that you think you found a trend and you get in at the 50% retracement, and then all of a sudden you have one bar that stabs down and then shoots right back up. If you guys have ever seen that, those are algos doing that typically, or a very, very, very big manual trader. But if it happens quickly, 9 out of 10 times, it's probably an HFT. Number three is momentum on pop stop runs, meaning once an area of support or resistance breaks, you typically have a lot of stops that are placed behind areas. What they'll do is if you start to crack a support or resistance level, if you ever notice the relative price start to speed up, so it starts to shoot through that level very, very quickly, that's not all HFTs, but it is triggered by HFTs where they're probing that resistance, and then all of a sudden you see on like time and sales, or you see on your price chart just a flurry of buying right at that level. If it's a lot of orders, odds are it's not people because people aren't that fast. If you see hundreds or thousands of trades executing very, very quickly, that's more than likely HFTs grabbing those stops and creating that momentum run. Okay. And then the fourth is what I just showed you, where they trap slow traders during news. And this is why I say, don't try to guess what's going to happen when a news piece comes out. If you're like, okay, I think housing is going to be good at 10, so let me buy right at 9:09 or 9:59, and then hope it goes in my favor. Odds are you're going to get whatever stop you have in taken out. I've seen it happen for years and years and years now. And it didn't always used to be that way. You know, it was back in the early 2000s, it was kind of predictable. Like, guys actually made their living trading news. And, you know, there's probably some people out there that are pretty successful at it, but it's definitely gotten a lot harder, if not damn near impossible. So that was the example on the fake out breakout and the news trap yesterday. Let's go, you know, for anybody who's saying like, look, I'm not a day trader, this doesn't affect me. Let me show you how this affects you on a longer term basis. Okay, so this is actually a daily chart of the E-mini S&P from about the start of February. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 3.5, almost 4 months, right? So the market, and this again, this is the S&P 500 futures contract. So this is a major barometer of the overall market. One thing you'll notice, oops, let me come back here. One thing you'll notice is here in the beginning of April, we had very, very clear resistance through this 1880 level. And then the market made a run and made a breakout intraday. And it may have been pre-market. I can't remember exactly. But basically what happened is it sucked a lot of buyers in for the breakout, probably people that wanted to catch another bull run like we had back in February. And look what happened. It slammed down. As soon as it broke the low of the prior day, the momentum really, really picked up, and we had a sell-off for about a week. And then more recently, last week or the week before that, we had a even more clear resistance level here. I think it was on May 12th or 11th or something. 1880s again. You know, the market made a run. This time, it actually closed above it, and it gave longer-term investors and swing traders and position traders time to get in. Right. So what happened, a lot of people saw this and they were buying at either market close or the open of the next day. And then it looked like it was going to pull back and go. But look what happened. It came back, took out the breakout levels low. So basically everybody who was long, and again, I don't know, I'm only speculating on this, but just based on the technical analysis books, everybody who bought the breakout or everybody who bought somewhere on this breakout day probably stopped out on this big panic day. Pretty interesting, right? Now, what I do and what my strategy is all about is anticipating where the market is going to cause people pain, right? Okay, if we get a breakout and if the breakout fails, where's it going to fail? Who's going to be trapped? And where's it going to go to? These are the type of questions that we talk about in the trading room. So as soon as we started to break this level, for those of you that were in the trading room, you know this was a really sweet day. We had what we call a power momentum trade where we shorted, and you know it was like an 8-point run. It was really great. And then we've been stuck in this channel for a couple of days. For anybody who swing trades equities, let's take a look at AT&T. All right. So you can see this is the past couple of months. This is what I call swing trade trapping, where again, you know, you'll follow the technical analysis books. And I don't even have moving averages on here, but a lot of people like to trail their stops behind moving averages. You know, you'll notice we had a breakout here, and then look what happened. Big gap down, takes out the prior low, snaps down even lower, so it breaks this support level, traps those guys, causes them pain, taking out that prior high. And look how it closes, like right below it or right above it, right? It's like they go for everybody. They're taking all of those stops. And then here you can see this is a little bit of a longer term one where you actually get a confirmed breakout, pulls back, doesn't take out the breakout bar low, double tops and fails, right? So that's not so much a trap, that's more of a failure. But I just want to show you how this stuff works. And if you're trading these extremely, extremely liquid, less volatile stocks, this stuff happens all over the place. You know, this is why I don't trade big cap stocks. I trade futures and I trade small cap equities and obviously Bitcoin. But there at this point in time, there's not really any professional algos in Bitcoin. It's just it's not a mature enough market, but they will be there, trust me. This is my trading strategy for the E-mini S&P. This is our day trading chart. Let me wait for this to catch up. Looks like we have a little bit of a delay. There we go. So this is a few days ago. This is what I just call low volume momentum stop running. So we actually, you'll notice that there's no trade signals on this chart. But even if there were, we wouldn't be trading during this time. You'll notice that the market is basically just whipsawing all over the place. Yes, it has a little bit of an uptrend, but it is a really, really ugly uptrend. It snaps above support, below support, above support, below support. It doesn't hold the breakout highs and lows. It just, what it does is it runs up, traps buyers, comes down, stops them out, comes back up, sucks them in again. This is just really, really ugly price action. So this is more of a day trading strategy. This is what we do at the E-mini Academy, but this is just an example of an algo-driven market. So for you guys that are in the trading room, I know we've got a mixture of guys and ladies that are in our trading room every day, and also a lot of you that aren't in our trading room every day. For those of you that are in the trading room, you know that these are the times that when we say, look, guys, if you ever hear me say, look, the algos are running stops, or it's just, low volume chop, it's only algos and idiots trading right now, to stay away. And yes, you may miss a move in the market, but from a probability standpoint, it's a lot better just to sit back and let the algos run everybody else's stop. And I'll show you kind of the opposite end of the coin when you actually do want to trade. Okay. Now, we've covered quite a bit of stuff, talked a little bit about some of their strategies, went into more depth on the stop running, since I think that's the one that probably frustrates the most amount of people. But there are some benefits to HFT as well. Like I mentioned, with the momentum plays, they can actually cause really big moves in the market. And if you know how to anticipate that stuff, you can get behind it. But you have to understand how the algos work and what they look for first. But just on like a higher level, talking about, is HFT good or bad? I'm neutral to it. I just look at it and say it is what it is. What do we have to do to work around it? I just want to give you something that they're not going to talk about on the 60 Minutes or, the news programs, or you're not going to read this in on any like financial blogs. But some of the actual positives of HFT is it replaces slower market makers. So, for anybody who's tried to trade penny stocks or, OTC pink sheet stuff, that getting a fill can be a real pain in the ass, right? It can be very, very difficult. It's like you put a limit order in, say you're trying to buy on the ask, you should have an immediate fill. Sometimes it can take anywhere from a few seconds to a few minutes. And the benefit here is you can actually get quicker fills sometimes. More liquidity, because honestly, guys, if HFT went away, the liquidity would be maybe half of what it is. Again, I don't know the exact number, but volume has already fallen off over the past few years. The algos do provide some liquidity. Also, tighter spreads, which equates to lower transaction costs, quicker fills sometimes. And so I'll just say again, HFT is not inherently evil. It's not like some master corporation that's like sitting back there, but at the same time they are, right? At the same time they are saying, like, look, we're going out and trading is a competition and we're going to make money. But that's the market, right? It's not HFT. Everybody wants to point the finger at HFT. It's just the market. HFT is just an evolutionary technology. This is the way the markets are now. Sure, there's going to be some regulation. Sure, it's going to evolve over time. But you need to be aware of it, and you need to be aware of how it affects you as a trader. Otherwise, if you stay with the old stuff, you're not going to really progress. Right. So let's talk about how to win in today's market. All right. The first thing that I'll say is you don't have to like adopt or invent your own software to try to directly compete with the HFTs. In fact, I think that would be a huge mistake if you said, look, okay, I want to go in and I want to scalp and I want to fight these algos. Number one, to have the technology and the speed that they have, you need tens of millions of dollars, like at least $50 to $100 million to really develop a strong HFT firm. Since the game has changed, you need to know how to avoid getting run over by the algos. All right, so this means like recognizing old patterns that don't work and old strategies that don't work. If you're still trying to use the stuff that they taught in Technical Analysis 101, and look, I've been saying this since 2008, 2009, I've seen this coming, but now it's prevalent and everybody knows about it. So, you just really need to know what's not working anymore. And, just like the VHS and the 8-track and the floppy disk and even the old camera film are no longer a part of our daily lives, at least for most people, a lot of these older trading strategies aren't as well, like scalping, right? And I said this a couple times, but I think scalping is dead. It used to work really well in the late 90s and the early 2000s. But, back then you were competing human against human. Now it's human against emotionless, super fast computer. You're going to lose every time. And this is my personal opinion. You may or disagree or agree. My personal opinion is don't trade during news, meaning when a big news event comes out, if you're already in a trade, okay, cool, maybe let it play out if you're profitable. But don't try to like guess what's going to happen when the news comes out. So this is just a news calendar. And today we had existing home sales at 10, pre-market we had jobless claims at 8:30. So what I'll do is I'll look at the Econoday calendar, and you can just find this on NASDAQ, or you can use any calendar you want, Forex Factory, I don't care. But just look at the important news pieces, the ones that have stars next to them, and those are the times that I would avoid trading. I would just say, look, guys, we have news coming out. Just kind of sit on your hands. Don't do anything right now. Let the algos run stops and do their craziness and see how the market behaves after that. And then finally, old technical analysis doesn't work. Algos are built to take advantage of common knowledge. Back 10 years ago, trading off of moving averages and simple MACD and not really having a complete trading strategy, it worked. Now, if you follow the old analysis, there's no edge, there's no advantage anymore. It's just like a casino. If you're a casino and you put out a game that the casino wins 10% of the time, you're gonna lose money, right? The next thing I'll say, and I always like to say, the quality of the answers that you get are based on the quality of the questions that you ask. So I think this is a very high quality question to ask. Who is on the opposite side of my trade, right? Anytime that I'm trading any market, I'm asking, okay, who am I trading against? And you'll never know for sure, but you can have a pretty good idea. In the stock and futures and Forex and options market, you're trading primarily, and again, there's like subsets of these, but you're primarily trading against HFT algos, professional traders, who a professional trader may work for a hedge fund, a big institution, may work for himself, and then retail traders, people like you and me. In the high liquidity, like Apples and Googles of the world, it's more HFTs and pros. In Bitcoin, it's virtually all idiots. No offense to anybody who trades Bitcoin, but that's why I've done really, really well trading Bitcoin, is because it's been just such stupid money in that market. That it's been emotional. You get 30, 40% swings. That's because of emotional retail traders. So my advice would be to avoid stocks and markets dominated by HFT. For example, low liquidity, or excuse me, low volatility, high liquidity stocks, basically stocks that don't move a whole lot, that trade a lot of volume. And if you are going to trade markets that have HFT in them, like obviously, the futures markets have HFT, and we trade E-minis here at the E-mini Academy, and we teach people how to trade E-minis. My advice is to only trade when market conditions are favorable. Okay, now what does that mean? And I don't have 90 minutes to go into depth, but we are doing a free boot camp in a little over a week that I'll tell you about, and we're going to go into a lot of depth with this. But basically, like, the high level answer is trade when a large group is experiencing pain. Okay, I always like to ask, who's on the opposite side? What are people thinking, right? Who's winning? Who's losing? Who's in control, buyers or sellers? Where are the inflection and the pain points? And if you can think in like a mass psychology point of view, it's going to really add a lot of clarity to your trading, as opposed to just getting obsessed over the latest and greatest indicator. And stay away when it's only algos and idiots trading, because sometimes the best trade is no trade. And you have to know when to push the gas and when to pull back. All right. And I'm going to answer, or I'm going to open this up for questions here in a second. But I do want to tell you guys about a free 4-day boot camp that we're going to have actually the first week of June. So in I think like a little over a week. What I'm going to cover here is a few things. Basically, step by step, how to use our rules-based strategy for the E-mini futures market. But even more specific to what we're talking about today, the best market conditions for trading, right? When to trade and when to avoid the markets completely. Because there's some days that, you know, in the trading room we'll have 5, 10, 20 trades or more. There's other days where we'll have maybe one or two. And it doesn't matter, because you have to know when to push the gas and when to pull back. Also, how to anticipate big moves caused by HFT activity. Okay, this is a huge one. Like my mission over the past 6 to 12 months has been to really learn when the market is most likely to have either a big panic or a big bull run, and when that's going to be triggered by high frequency algos. And we've gotten pretty good at it. You know, it's definitely an art, but I want to teach you guys how to anticipate these big moves that kind of goes hand in hand with, you know, understanding what group is in pain, what, you know, where the pressure's building, where stuff is breaking down. You know, those are the kind of things that you really need to know. And so this boot camp is free for all E-mini Academy members, and it's going to be Monday, June 2nd through Thursday, June 5th. And that's going to be, we're going to start that at 2 p.m. Eastern time, and that's going to go probably till about 4:30. Maybe a little bit longer, depending on how many questions you guys have. And we are going to have recasts available. So if you can't make it at that time, that's cool. You're going to be able to see it again and get all your questions answered. But again, any active members of the E-mini Academy, you actually have free access to this 4-day boot camp. If you're not a member with the E-mini Academy, let me tell you guys our membership options if you're interested in that. We actually have two different membership programs. Our self-paced program is really cool, and we're giving this away to our self-paced members as well. This is basically where you get a monthly license of our MapTrade Signal software that we use for the futures market, the online curriculum, also the daily videos that we put out, the recap and the forecast videos, and I think this is really cool because we've never done this before. This is the first time we've done this 4-day boot camp. And so, you know, if you sign up, it's $297 a month. You can sign up for a month, get into the 4-day boot camp, check it out. If you love it, great. We'd love to have you stay with us. But I think you'll get a lot out of that class either way. And then we also have our Pro Trader Challenge for those of you that are like really serious about your trading and you want to be in the trading room with us every day. But basically what you do, guys, if you want to sign up for this, if you're already a member, I know we have a lot of members in here, you don't need to do anything. You're going to get those emails. And I think Chris Henry, you may have already sent those out. You guys already have a seat reserved in there. But if you're not a member and you want to sign up, just go to eminiacademy.com/HFT for high frequency trading. And whenever you register, you'll get an email with your login to the members area. And then we can actually help you set up your software, or you can do it on your own, either way. And then we'll automatically reserve you a spot for that. So I think whenever, yeah, here's the page. Whenever you go to this page, it'll basically bring you here, and you can do add to cart for the self-paced program. Or if you want to apply to the Pro Trader Challenge and just hear more how that works, you can do that. That's a really intense year-long training program. And it's not for everybody. I'll just say that. I mean, there is an investment. And, you know, if you're not really ready to hit the ground running, I'd recommend starting with the self-paced program. And we wanted to make this affordable for everybody who's really serious about their trading. But, yeah, we're basically we're making this this boot camp free for everybody who signs up by the end of the month. And, again, it's June 2nd to 5th. So, yeah, that's what it's about, guys. And we've even got this nifty little countdown clock. So, yeah, basically whenever the class fills up, we're going to take this down, or by the end of the month, whichever one happens first. But we'd love to have you guys there. It's going to be a really great class. And, again, if you can't make it to the live class, don't worry. We're going to actually have recasts of it. And there's some new training material that we're actually releasing at this boot camp. We're going to go into a lot of depth of our new trade setups, the power momentum trades that we've really dialed in with the HFT stuff. We're also going to talk about the specific market conditions that we want before trading gold, oil, and currency futures, because gold right now, for those of you that like trading commodities, gold, I think, is poised to make a pretty big move. You know, I did a blog post just talking about, like, from the investment side, but I think from a trading side, gold is really coiling up. You can see here for, you know, the past 30 or 60 days, it's really been coiling up. And we really only like to trade commodities when there's big range, like when the market was panicking back here last year, last summer, or when it went parabolic here. But whenever it's coiling up, it's best to stay away from those markets. So, you know, we do trade all of the stock indices, we trade the currencies, we trade commodities, but we have very specific market conditions that we're looking for before we trade those markets. Because if you're trading when algos are just running stops, you're going to get dominated. We also have new trade management and entry plans to help you avoid getting high-ticked by algos. In other words, you know, if you have the problem where you are, you know, you get all into a trade, comes up, grabs your stop, and then runs. We have some strategies that we've been testing and working with for about 6 months that that we feel are going to really help you finesse your entries and your exits. And then that's it. So, you know, if you guys want to join us on that free 4-day boot camp, we'd love to have you. Again, it's just eminiacademy.com/HFT. So if you go there and do your registration, you'll get immediate access to the members area. And then you'll have a seat in the class. So I'll go ahead and I saw some questions coming in. So feel free to rock and roll with some questions, guys, and I'll keep up with them as much as I can. And I'll go back for anybody who posted them during the webinar. Jeremy, if you're a member already, you automatically have a spot. So don't worry about it. You'll get the emails and you're solid, man. Yep, absolutely. Andres, according to what I understand, you always trade with the trend. What you use to determine uptrend or downtrend? So we don't have time to go into, like, exactly what we use to determine a trend, but I'll tell you, we do trade with market strength. Like, on a day trading basis, at least in the futures market, we trade with market strength. I'm not about picking tops or bottoms. When it comes to equities, we do look for, like, parabolic moves and things like that. But yeah, that's something that actually on day one of the boot camp, day one of the boot camp, we'll talk about how to use our strategy, like the step-by-step basics of, you know, what we use to determine a trend, what we use to find a trade area, and so on and so forth. Yeah, this is recorded, so technology cooperating, we will hopefully have a recording out to you. David, the minimum that you need to open an e-mini account is somewhere in between $2,500 and $5,000. You know, and I think that's okay. Like, you know, I'm obviously not a trading advisor, so I can't tell you what's right for you. But the better capitalized you are, or the more capitalized you are, the better. And I actually recommend, you know, if you have a smaller account, definitely SimTrade. You know, develop your skill first. There's no need to open an account right away and start trading cash until you really know what you're doing. I don't understand. Hopefully a computer can control the price enough to be able to stop at will. Well, so what they do is they hunt for liquidity, Matt. They basically will look for where they think a lot of the stop orders are, right? And this was the problem with the Forex market. You know, a lot of brokers could see their own clients' orders, and so they would run those stops. It was like seeing, you know, the full market. And I don't know exactly what the HFTs can see and what they can't see. I just know that they have an advantage, and they get preferential treatment at the exchanges. And they know what people do, right? They know that if somebody puts a, you know, takes a breakout, they're likely to put their stop below the last pivot low. And that's an inflection point that they will 9 out of 10 times drive for, right? And so that's something we'll talk about at the boot camp, is like those types of scenarios. Like, you know, when you get into a trade, what are the algos likely to do, right? And this is a new conversation. Like, we've never had this conversation before of, well, for those of you that are in the room, we've been talking about this recently, but you never, a few years ago, you didn't have to think, okay, well, what are the algos going to try to do, right? That's something that's relatively new. JD, for $297 a month. JD, so for the self-paced program, you get the software, and you'll learn how to use the software and find your own trades. And you also get daily videos from us, as well as strategy optimization reports, which what that does is it shows you what parameters are working best in current market conditions, like what stop sizes and profit targets and things like that. If you want to be in our trading room, we do have a trading room that's open Monday through Friday. That's part of the Pro Trader Challenge. And we keep that a very, very small, intimate group. This isn't like some big chat room. And, you know, we don't need a chat room where you need to like call trades. We're actually about anticipating trades. What you'll find in a lot of the chat rooms that call trades, like anybody that does like a trade alert service where you get an email or you're in a chat room where somebody says, hey guys, I'm in this level, especially if you're trading equities, you got to be real careful with that, with this. A lot of times they're front running that. And so you'll get in, they'll say, hey, look, I'm in it. You know, I'm in Apple, or not Apple, like it'll usually be like small cap stocks. I'm in ABCD at 501. And then by the time you get that alert, it's at 507. So what our trading room is all about is teaching you how to anticipate that, so you can get in and you know what you're looking for, so you don't have to rely on somebody to tell you when to get in. We're not looking to create like dependent traders. We want you to be independent and develop your skill as a trader. This isn't like you know, something where, you know, you get in and you learn it overnight. There is a development process that comes with trading. And that's why we're doing this 4-day boot camp. You know, we want to fast track that and hopefully get you like 60 days worth of knowledge into just a few days. Also, if you make small wins, how do you build the commissions? Yeah, that's why it's not good to scalp, David. You know, commissions are a very large portion of trading, and commissions have come down significantly. You know, in the early 2000s, we were paying like 14 or 17 round turn, you know, to get in and out of a trade. Now it's down to like four. So that's why it's important not to overtrade and not to try to scalp, and take hundreds of trades all day, because that'll just eat up all your profits. Winslow, I think they're trying to figure that out, man. The question is, do you see the SEC stepping in to regulate the use of HFTs? The thing is, like, you're not going to see, at least this is my prediction, I guess, is you're not going to see like a massive movement by the government to try to ban HFTs. I mean, they're going to try to make it a fair playing, or a level playing field. But if they just banned or like got rid of HFTs, that would kill market liquidity. The volume would go down, I don't know, by half or a third. So it'll be really interesting to see what develops over the next few months and years. Carlos, example of how they can do it on Forex. It works the same way on Forex, Carlos. I don't know exactly what the percentage is that HFTs are in Forex, but I know it's pretty significant. Any market with liquidity now has a HFT in it. And I think it's just important to stay away from markets that are like absolutely dominated, or at least know what the HFTs are doing and the market conditions and the patterns to trade, and those that are like obsolete now. Yeah, Bonex, I mean, you can use the technical analysis that you use. We do actually have a course specifically for equities at traderformula.com. Because what works in small cap equities is different from what we want to use in the futures market. But yeah, a lot of the analysis and the education that you'll learn in that, you'll be able to move over into equities. When you trade, do you trade using your own algo or trade manually? Good question, Philip. I trade manually, and I think pretty much everybody executes it orderly. Executes it manually, but we do have something that I can use to help me place those orders. But for me, I just like finessing the entries. Again, we're not like scalping or hyperactively trading. I don't have the mindset for that. The average trade for us is anywhere in between like 15 to 30 minutes, depending on how the market's moving. Again, we're not fighting for a tick here or there. We're working around the algos. We're not trying to compete in their playing field of like fighting for microseconds and fills. Our game is more of like intraday swing trading, like not swing trading where we're holding for days on end, but we're looking to swing moves. We're not looking to scalp for a tick here or there. Kevin, it varies. We like to keep it well below 100 people. And actually, whenever we do a bigger group, we like to keep it actually at or below 50 people. How long is the trading open? It's Monday through Friday all day, David, and we're most active when the market's most active. So you'll notice, when the market's active, we're actively trading and really going over every trade setup. And the cool thing is you can actually post your charts in the room and get feedback from us. The self-paced program, no. The live room and the weekly training is reserved for the Pro Trader Challenge. Just because, again, we want to keep that a very small group. And we wanted to give you guys a way, like a really affordable way to do this on your own if you want to get started trading. Dude, would you ever do a friendly challenge where students can trade against you or Chris, Henry, all paid vacation? Yeah, that'd be fun. That's an idea. We'll see what happens after London. We've got a lot of meetups planned around the world first. Yeah, Chris, the map trade signal software is for E-minis. Chris, all question is what markets are dominated by HFTs? Anything with liquidity. So stocks, futures, options, forex, they all have HFT, but you want to stay away from the markets that are like dominated by it. For example, the low volatility, high liquidity equities. Sam, I'm not sure what you mean by do you show stop losses? We use stop losses, and yes, we have a stop loss plan that goes along with our management plan. Yeah, Andreas, we manage every trade. Yeah, there's no like set and forget. We're active in the markets when we're trading. Which is the ideal capital? Well, Bonex, I'm not a trading advisor, so I can't tell you like an ideal capital for you. I think if you start with a minimum of 5K and you're risking, say, a point on any given trade, you're going to be risking about 50 bucks. And that's 1%, which I think is reasonable. I don't think you want to get over leveraged and start, risking like 5-10% per trade. That would get you into trouble because the futures markets are leveraged, right? And that's why it's so important to, develop your skill first because, leverage can work in your favor, can help you grow really fast, but it can also kill you really fast too if you don't know what you're doing. Wouldn't it be easier for you to move away from the S&P futures than try to adapt to HFTs? Not necessarily. I mean, I want to trade where there's opportunity. That's why I don't trade futures all day, every day. I trade when the market is ripe, right? And when the market conditions are right. I do the same with equities. I do the same with Bitcoin. I trade where the opportunity is. That's why with Bitcoin, I've only taken, I think now 10 trades in the past 7 months. They've all been, well, 9 out of 10 have been really great trades, but just like any professional trader, you trade where the opportunity is. Liran, what is actually happening when the HFT when it goes for its prey? Does it just buy selling massive quantities? There's a few different types of strategies that they use, different types of orders, and different ways that they work the market. I don't have time to cover like all of those today, but yeah, I mean they do things to just stuff orders. They do just spam orders where they'll create a flurry of activity at a breakout level, and then they'll trap a lot of people. Like there's quite a few things that they do, and I don't know all of them. Nobody really knows everything that they do. A lot of their best strategies are, still protected, I imagine. But you're gonna do the camp presentations. Yeah, we'll have other webinars in the future. Good. Well, how many instruments do you trade? Good question. So how many do we monitor simultaneously? So we look at on one monitor, we'll have all of the indices. Like here, for example, this is the YM right now. We'll have the YM, the NQ, the ES, and the TF, so the four major indices. And then, so we'll kind of monitor these four at the same time. There's actually a video of Chris Henry, I think, recently trading. I think it was in three or four trades at the same time, but that's kind of rare. I mean, usually it's one or two. And then we monitor the gold and oil markets when they're in play. Also currencies, which really haven't been in play recently. So yeah, any given time, we're not actively like entering more than a couple. And it's actually on average maybe one or two. George, yeah, we trade the NQ, the YM, the TF, and the ES. Think this is chat is getting a little jumbled. I'm not sure if Omnovia is combining these questions. Adriano, yeah, so we're going to London end of the month. And yeah, we're planning some meetups and some training out there. So yeah, if you're following us, you'll definitely hear about that. Yeah, we do have the DAX. I haven't been trading that too actively recently, but I think the liquidity and the respect in the market might be picking up a little bit. But yeah, the DAX, not so much the FTSE, but yeah, the DAX, the Euro, Kevin, do PTC members ever come in person to the trading room? Yeah, so we did a week of live trading in Austin, Texas in December, and that was incredible. I think all the guys that were there loved it, and as far as I know, I think everybody walked away making money that week, so that was pretty cool. Do you trade high cap stocks when it becomes volatile? Philip, not really. I mean, I just like to focus on the lower cap stuff. It's easier for me to trade. And actually, Nikki, my wife, trades more of the equities every day. All right, guys. Well, we've been going for a little over an hour here. If you guys have any other questions, let me know. I hope you got a lot out of today. The HFT stuff is definitely interesting. It's something that hopefully you're aware of, and you understand kind of the way that it works. I know this is something I could talk about for 10 hours straight, and we still wouldn't have even scratched the surface of it. But at the end of the day, again, it's really just about knowing who's on the other side of your trade, avoiding stocks and markets that are just dominated by HFT. And if you are going to trade in markets that have HFT, just know, when it's the right time to trade, because not every trading day is created equal. Really start to think in terms of mass psychology, like, who's in this breakout, who, where's the market going to collapse from? And if you can see it from that perspective and you understand the patterns that, are obsolete today, that'll actually give you an even bigger advantage. So. Thanks, Gregory. Ricardo, you must have missed the whole part of talking about running stops and the different ways that they do that. A couple of the other things that we'll talk more in depth about at the boot camp is the high and low tick pullback areas, as well as, let me wait for this. There we go. High tick pullback areas, momentum on pop stop runs, and trapping traders during news, and how you can actually get big momentum pops after news. Because sometimes, the volume will actually fall off before news, and then after a news piece comes out, you'll get some really good trading opportunity. Yeah, guys, so I see we have a lot of people that are registering for that the boot camp. Again, it's going to be June 2nd through June 5th. Starts at 2, goes till late afternoon, and we will have recasts available for anybody that can't make it live. And certainly, if you guys have any questions, shoot us an email, give us a buzz. The link again is eminiacademy.com/HFT. And looking forward to having a great time. I'll see you guys soon in London. And yeah, hope you enjoyed it. Yeah, Monix, there will be recasts available. So if you can't make it, we'll have recordings for you guys. Ricardo, I did get that. How do they do it? Buy and sell massively. Yeah, I mean, like I said, there's a few different ways. There's a few different strategies that they employ, but the most common one is front running and quote stuffing, and basically just spamming orders, right? Where they'll actually entice and manipulate the market by putting a flood of thousands of orders in and not really filling much. And then, you know, sometimes that'll create the fake out breakout. Other times it'll, you know, do the pop stop run where it'll pop all the stops and they'll chase the pockets of liquidity. You know, there's a whole range, everything from just the scalping of a penny to creating those momentum pushes and probing the momentum pushes, basically hunting for those liquidity areas where everybody's stops are. So it's not like they, you know, they know, it's not like an exact science where they say, okay, well, everybody stops in the markets are right here at, you know, the price of 10. And so we're going to take it to 9.99 and reverse it. It's not like an exact science. They just know how most people trade, and their algos are built in a way to chase those orders, if that makes sense. Yeah, it's pretty crazy stuff. Yeah, and for those of you that that are getting set up, if you need help with the software, give Andrea a call. She just put her stuff in there. You know, if you have any questions about the program or the Pro Trader Challenge, feel free to give Mike Carter a call. And yeah, look forward to seeing you guys. If someone come up with a machine learning project to detect HFT. Yeah, it's called other HFT firms. Seriously, HFTs not only trade against people, but they trade against each other. You know, it's algos fighting algos. Somebody was asking about the new training material. All right, guys. Well, I hope you enjoyed this. Have a great day, and I will talk to you real soon. Take care.